Oh, thank you, everybody. Welcome to Build. I'm your host, Ricky Camilleri. For 6 seasons now, Netflix's Orange is the New Black has shown a light on women's stories rarely, if ever, seen on screen. Now, a standout among the standouts for every season has been our next guest, Dascha Polanco, who plays Diaz, and in this season, finds herself taking a plea deal for something she may not have done. Let's take a look.
Good morning, Litchfield Max, and greetings to our new cookies.
Wait, this isn't home. This is not home.
It is now.
I've been a bad, bad girl.
It's very different here.
I've been careless with a delicate man.
These girls are psychos. My bunkie? She does 4 poops a day.
What? First, my friends become not my friends. And then, given a color that other colors want to fight.
Blues and khakis have beef with each other. Pinks are safe out there.
Navigating adult female friendships is so complicated.
Where is Alec?
Don't you think it's weird we're the only people in here?
They want us to go down, regardless of what we did or didn't do. I'm scared.
You're gonna give up the rest of your life to protect some lousy criminal?
Well, I got his enemies these days.
Sometimes I wonder whose team you really are.
What else did Ruiz do?
Why are you lying to me?
She got to you already. They coming for me, but I'm gonna keep standing up.
You don't know how strong my girls are. We have iron wills.
And fucking nothing to lose.
Roll it out and wrist rolls it. Roll it out. Churn the butter. Churn the butter.
Everybody, please welcome the great Dascha Polanco. Hey.
Hi.
Thanks so much for being here.
Thank you.
You look amazing.
Thank you.
Congratulations on another season of Orange is the New Black, the show that just won't quit, that also stays great while not quitting. What is it like? I mean, I'm curious. You get onto this show in the first season, right? Mm-hmm. It's a kind of a new thing. It's a streaming show. It's one of Netflix's first shows. What were you thinking when you got that first job?
I have a job, right? For me, this is my first big thing. You know, I had done a couple of things, but not as big as this. The platform was new, but I was not focusing on what it was going to do for me. I was focusing on in the present, which was a beautiful thing. Because it was like, what am I going to do today with my other jobs? How am I going to handle this? I'm going to be able to, like, be part of a whole production. Yeah. So that was what I was most focused on. I really didn't, you know, where I was at as an actor was not even calling myself an actor. You know, when I went on that set and I met my co-stars and I spoke to them and I was able to like work with them and hear them and learn that they were able to say I'm an actress. Meanwhile, I'm like, wow, you can really say that? I was like, I'm a manager at a hospital, like doing a couple of acting gigs. And now—
Is that what you were doing? But when you got the job, you were a manager at a hospital?
Yeah, I had 2 jobs and I was doing my clinicals for nursing.
And you were auditioning at the same time?
Yeah.
Wow, that's incredible.
Yeah.
I
never thought what I was doing was incredible and how I was managing my time because I
was pretty amazing.
But when you're in that moment, that's not what you're looking at. I think that you're just hungry and you're hustling and you're like, I got to keep on doing this because I can't go back to where I came from. And so for me, it was like time management, like having 2 jobs from 7 to 3. I was in Brooklyn. And then 3 to 11 and then weekends doing what I had to do and then being a parent, I had a lot on my plate, but I was able to like always cook from my plate, right? Yeah. You like how I use the metaphors, cook and put it on my plate and serve
Send them up.
You know, wash the dishes right after.
So many plates.
A lot of plates. So many plates. But it goes to show that we only limit ourselves. we have so much potential, and we're, as women, as society, as men, we're limitless. We have so much ability to do what you set your mind to. And so when I entered the show, I was kind of like still sleeping. I did not know where this was going. I was just like, I'm given the opportunity to do what I've always dreamt to do as a little girl.
What was your audition like? How did you get the audition? Like, did you audition on tape and send it in? How did that go?
No, I had to go in, and it was kind of like, I was at a point where I was letting go. I had not done anything for a year. You know, I was not communicating with my managers much, you know, because when you're working, you're actively communicating with them. When you're like dormant, you're dormant. And I was dormant. And so I was like, this is not reliable. I need a reliable income. And so I'm going to stick to my nursing and stick to my central sterile management. And that's what I'm going to do, which I'm successful at. And then I got the call that I have this audition for the show. I had no idea. I was like, all right, I'll give it a chance. I worked overnight. I walked in there. I'm saying it was like timing aligned. The stars aligned. It was just for time for me to go and do what I was supposed to be doing. Because I'm telling you, I got home from an overnight shift. I mixed up the audition time. I was supposed to be there at 1, and I thought it was 2. So I had to get from Brooklyn to Varick Street in like a matter of like half an hour. And I was able to get there, no traffic, Battery Tunnel. Got parking in front of the building, in my scrubs. I was like, look, I can't even get dressed. Forget this. My hair was curly. I had a streak. My streak is mine. It's not Dayanara's. I did the blonde streak. Just so you know. And then I walk in there, I read, and I'm like, oh, great, yeah, the usual. Jen was like, you're great, you're fantastic, thank you. And I'm like, mm-hmm. Walk back and did my life, back to my, you know, working corporate and studying. And then I get a second call back on Monday, and my manager was so excited. And I was like, okay. I was like, relax, we're not there yet. You have a call back, and it conflicted with my clinicals, and you're not supposed to miss clinicals when you're a nurse. That's like essential. So it was a Saturday. Who auditions on a Saturday? No one, right? At 2:00, my clinicals were like from 7 a.m. to 3. And I was like, this is just like, great. I have to make a decision. So I couldn't lie that I was sick because my professor was a nurse. So I kind of had to be honest and tell her, listen, will you let me leave a little earlier? And I actually emailed Jen and said, can I come in a little earlier? Which doesn't happen. I don't recommend for you to email your casting director and say, can you change my audition time? That's not how you do it. It just happened that I took that risk, and it happened for me. Wow. I know it's not because I'm special or anything. It's just...
So you said the stars aligned to a certain degree.
Yeah,
it was
the right timing. When I got the confirmation that I was part of this, that was one of the moments that I realized how we're not present. Because at that moment when I got that news, I was at the dock at Long Island College Hospital, and I walked outside and I was in my scrubs and I just cried because of the excitement of my manager and him telling me your life is going to change. And I was like, I'm kind of crying because I have 2 jobs and I cannot just dedicate myself to acting. So I was already thinking about how am I going to do this?
What if this show doesn't actually take off? What if I just get a couple episodes?
Show take off. I didn't even know that. I was just like, I can't be available. I have responsibilities. I was not worried about the dynamics of a show, awards, the success of. I was not worried about any of that. I was
worried
about my responsibilities.
Yeah.
Because I'm just so used to always hustling and getting it that for me to take time to complete my dream. It was not ideal. It's never been ideal. It's always been putting people first. At that moment was a challenge, was a test. Who, at this point in your life, are you really gonna put yourself forward before anything? And so I kept one of the jobs. I had to let go of one of the management jobs, and I kept one of the jobs while I was filming this.
While you're filming the first season?
Yeah, and I got fired from that job. And I've never been fired, honey. I've always, like, you know, moved on and moved up. And it was I cried when I was fired because I was like, holy, what am I going to do now? Right? Yeah. Because the show hadn't come out. I didn't have a job. I had to go on unemployment. You know, I was living the life with my little Amex card. You know, you have to pay that once real quick, right away. And these are the things, this is real. This is what I was going through while this is happening. And when the show aired, like, everything changed from that point as far as, like, my visibility.
You were a standout right away in the first season. I remember when the first season came out. It wasn't just my opinion. It was that, you know, there were a number of actresses in the first season that I think immediately kind of stood out. And over the course of all the seasons, more have kind of popped here and there as the storylines have progressed. But there was something about you and, of course, about Taylor and about Uza in the first season that I remember everyone was like, these really focused on you as actresses.
Yeah, I mean... Look, for somebody that has always been insecure and not confident enough to think that she could go forward and audition as an actress and say, this is a dream, this will never be my reality, to be noticed by people every day of my life, I question all the time. Like, how can you tell, how do you know, like, I see old high school friends, I'm like, well, I don't even remember your name. Like, you know what I mean? For me to be noticed was not my goal, but to be noticed, it's so rewarding.
Did they know while you were shooting the first season that you had another job that you had kept and everything?
No, I didn't tell anybody.
You didn't tell anybody?
No.
Why?
Because I couldn't afford for them to not give me the opportunity thinking I couldn't handle the time. Right. So I didn't tell my job. I would not tell my job. And I would not tell them. I was like, I'm not, my co-stars knew. I remember Selene's knew, which she plays Gloria and Diane. And, you know, the immediate Uzo knew, Natasha as well. Like, I had conversations with them because I learned from people that dedicated themselves to this all along. And I'm telling you, what most I remember is how they were able to claim, I'm an actress. I do this full time. And for me, it was like, I'm a central sterile manager.
Well, that's because, this is something that I relate to, when you don't grow up around people who grew up in this industry or are around this industry, be it acting, be it writing, be it directing, be it making music or something, it seems completely impossible that you could ever refer to yourself as that thing that they're doing, because how would you make a living? How would you live a life?
Exactly.
Your life, when you come from a certain kind of socioeconomic position, is solely defined based off of how you make money and how you live your life and how you raise your family. And acting, writing, directing in no way seems like a plausible way to do that. So as soon as you say, I'm an actor, it's like, oh, I don't make any money for any, I don't do anything.
Yeah, they're like, oh, you're an actor? Yeah. I remember when I was, I used to tell like immediate people like, oh, I just filmed this show. And they would be like, oh, okay, great. And then when it came out, how they were like, you're part of this show. And I was like, yeah, I kind of told you guys that I was. I think it's a lot changed for me and still changing, because so much happened in such a short period of time that for a woman of color to grow up in New York City, to have had responsibilities that maybe are not ideal for everyone, and to think that everything is against you, and knowing that right now, nothing that's against you can stop you. I was like, I'm going forward. And although at times I know we're talking about the show, but this is real about the show. At times we've been on for so long, and maybe it has not placed me where I've wanted to be, right? Because we think like, okay, this is gonna open the door to this. There's so much more work to be done because the opportunities are not all there. I'm still working towards that. But I know that because of my trajectory, it takes an hour instead of 15 minutes to get there, but I know that I'm going to get there, right? And that's for everyone. It might take someone a year to be like super successful, whatever that means, because success is determined by the individual. And a year for you, but it could take me 5 minutes. But whatever you determine your success, and you need to be aware of that, you need to own that. And now me, as a woman, I know that I am an actress, I came here as an immigrant, and that this is only the beginning. And I have I'm doing it real nice and slow and steady, because I'm going to forever be, right? There's no stopping
You got a show, too. You got six seasons of a show that helps that
That's
slow
a stamp that I always
well.
Carry.
Yeah.
But I have a platform. I have a following. And me as a person, I know who I am and what I'm putting out in the universe and how I treat others. And I know that only good karma can be back to me.
What was it like coming from this show and getting cast in something like Joy? Where, you know, it's the biggest star in the world at that moment, probably still. And the biggest director in Hollywood of that moment as well, coming from American Hustle and Silver Linings Playbook. I think De Niro was in that movie, De Niro, Jennifer
Isabella
Lawrence.
Mussolini.
Was Bradley Cooper in that?
Virginia
in that
Madsen.
One? Right.
Bradley Cooper. I mean.
So what was that? That was really your first job sort of after.
Huge feature film?
Yeah. But like after Orange is the New Black or during Orange is the New Black,
Yeah, I think
right?
it was season two that I did it. It was 2015. I mean, I was in Boston for 3 months and I went to a table read and I'm sitting in front of people that I'm like, what am I doing here? What am I doing here? And like intimidated because you're working with a reputable director. Me? Not that I've worked with directors, respectful directors, but David O. Russell?
Right.
I mean, I cannot tell you how... At that moment, you're so incredulous of what's going on. It's like, I'm going to wake up any minute. This is not really happening. And then when you're given that opportunity and that camera goes on, you're like, it's either do or die, girl. So you better show it. Yeah. Show it. Once you're put to the test, there's only one way out, and it's to take that damn test and pass it and ace it. And that's what I try. You know what I mean? I shouldn't say I try. I'm doing it. You know.
And Russell throws. I mean, he doesn't leave you alone out there in front of the camera.
Oh my
he
God.
Throws everything at you.
Let me tell you. And he allowed me to share his moment of the creative process. When you're working with these directors, David O. Russell, Ryan Murphy, Scorsese. I mean, Billy Woodruff. Like these are creative individuals that allow you to share this process, and I try to like just absorb as much as I can because these are moments in times. I grew up watching these things, right? They're moments in my past or experiences. Or we all like use entertainment as a way or like a point of like remembering memories and learning as an actor. When I get asked how does it feel like to work with them or what do you feel as an actor like to give feedback on working with them? The only feedback I can give is like, I worked with them. Yes, but what I'm doing is I'm this sponge and I'm absorbing from them because that's what makes you have quality and have great presence when you're able to like learn from your peers in leadership, right?
When did you work with Scorsese?
This year.
This year?
Yeah.
Are you in The Irishman?
Yes, I am.
Oh, shit.
Yeah, I'm in The Irishman.
What can you tell us about The Irishman? This is for
I mean,
those,
I can't
for,
say much, but I mean, yeah.
For those that don't know, it's Martin Scorsese's new movie. It's with Al Pacino and Robert De Niro. It's like ballooned to like a $250 million Netflix production gangster movie about the hitman who potentially killed Jimmy Hoffa, played by Robert De Niro, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Who do you play in it?
I play his nurse.
You play his nurse.
And I have it's a guest role. And I was so excited when, let me tell you something. I was, actually, this is funny because when I auditioned, I was so nervous in front of De Niro and Scorsese. I was like,
they were there in your audition.
The callback.
Yeah.
And I was like, I'm going to probably use the bathroom. I'm going to probably just not be able to talk because I was frozen. I was like, look, like when you have goals, you have goals. And that was one of my goals. And I was like, check this. When I was walking on 14th Street on the way to the gym, honey, it was cold. And I was like, I'm hot. I'm really hot. And I got the call. I just cried. I always cry. I'm like, I'm happy. And then I cry. I was crying as I'm walking on 14th Street. I don't care. I don't care. I'm walking on 14th Street. And you know, Bob, I love him. This is my second time around. So,
You know. Bob, go back.
We go back. That was, it's just, look, anything is possible. Anything is possible.
So now what is it like coming back to Orange is the New Black every season after having these experiences away from set?
Well, it's home for me. And it doesn't change how I perceive every other job. It just goes to, It's like any other situation. You have an experience and you come back and you do what you're supposed to do. I don't go back thinking like, well, here I am, guys. I worked with David O. Russell. I can't really talk to you guys. Like, no, there's no, this is home and this is the baby. This is like when you go to your auntie's house. You know, you go out there, you see the world and you come back. And it's everything sprung from it. So.
And now this season is, it's not necessarily a reboot of it, but it is sort of taking all of the characters and putting them in a new place and yes. somewhat fresh storylines, even though we're jumping off of the riot that happened at the end yes. of the last season. Your character specifically is in a pretty odd predicament. What did you think when you got the scripts for what was going to happen?
We get the scripts every weeks in advance.
Oh, so you're shooting episodes, like it's not block shot.
No. And it's not like in advance, like you don't know what this arc, you don't know it throughout. So you're like living in that moment. And when I first got it, being left off like that, I was a little nervous. I was like, am I in the show? Am I not in the show? What's going on? I just shot a guard and I'm off. It was a new show, new set, new prison, new women. So there's a lot of like, testing the loyalty, testing strength.
New guards, too.
Oh, my God. The abuse from the guards. When I read that, I was like, okay, you know, the usual abuse. But when I was physically in that state and I was down there as Dayanara getting kicked and getting hit and the bruises, when they did the makeup on me, and I was like, you know, it's you just wake up and you realize there's women out there. There's incarcerated men, vice versa, that are actually in this position where they're physically being abused. And in every which way. I think there's abuse in every which way. But that specifically, when I was getting kicked, that was a moment where I was like, oh, my God. And I was like crying, not because of the pain, but because of the vulnerability of the individual as a human being.
I think Orange is the New Black does that a lot with the characters. You yeah. find yourself in moments, you could be upset or crying because of the way that a storyline goes, but there are brief moments where you think to yourself, oh, this is just a small glimpse of what happens to people yeah. in that are incarcerated and the stories that they have, which we never actually
it
tell.
Definitely educates and it like brings up to light some things that we've swept under the rugs or many things that we swept. I think that's the beautiful thing of this show, that from the beginning it has reached audiences throughout the world about things that we never knew. Women giving birth in prison, transgendered issue, I mean, mental health issues, Black Lives Matter. We've done so much as actors to bring authenticity to them, but also the writers and Genji have a way of like being so relatable to the current events and pop culture that it just makes me proud that I'm part of like art that it reaches the masses. Right.
It also does it in a very stylistic way. I loved the opening of the first season, of the first episode
yes.
in this season where Uza is watching everybody, like she's watching TV, and it's extremely theatrical. It's like you're watching an experimental theater production yes. in like downtown New York, where everybody is kind of doing an expressionistic interpretation of where their characters are in the storyline for the rest of the season. I thought it was so beautiful.
Isn't it?
Well done. Yeah.
Thank you. I love the whole idea of it. I think that we don't have to show it so superficially. I think that there's a way of like artistically reaching the whole idea that we're more empathetic, no? Like the modern dance, the you know, when you see red as there's beauty in everything, and I love that they use that as the beginning and not just like dark, here we go, let's show the abuse from the very beginning. I think that that's a beautiful way of like even depicting like mental health, right?
Yeah. I mean, it opens up how much you can feel for this person. It's yes. like you talking about limits before. That person's imagination becomes limitless, therefore your empathy for them becomes exactly. a little more limitless as well yeah. because you're not just sort of stuck in a very grounded, harsh reality
exactly.
consistently. Let's get some questions from our audience. Who's
yes.
a question? Right here. You have a microphone.
Because I could talk for days, honey.
So could I.
Hi. You're so beautiful. I just want to say
thank
that.
Thank you. So are you.
Thank you. My question is, like, what advice do you have for, like, young girls, like, millennials who, like, want to go into the acting, like, career and, like, pursue that as, like, a career?
Well, do you love acting?
I mean, I'm definitely, like, I'm interested in it.
do you love acting?
Like movies.
What do you love?
I think I love like the idea of being like another character and like
having... No, I mean like not about acting, but what's something... The point of that is that there's so many things in the entertainment industry that you might love and not necessarily acting. Because acting, it's beautiful. I love it. But it's not necessarily for everyone. You have to really be aware that it's going to hit you and knock you down, and you're going to get a lot of criticism, and you're not going to feel enough, and you're not going to get the opportunity like everybody else. Not to discourage you, but if that's something you love, then you know that love comes with a lot of sacrifices. So that's something that you have to be aware. I mean, we have to understand that in order for us to get diversity in front of the screen, we have to have diversity behind the screen and like write, produce, direct. There's set design. There's like costume design. There's so much behind that it's, you're part of the creation, and you can be part of like, I want to be a superhero, and you could be part of like the costume for the superhero and still be in that creative like world without having to be in front of the camera. So it's just whatever you set your mind to, whether it's acting, whether it's like chef, whether it's a writer, whether it's, you know, central sterile manager, a nurse, you have to really love that, because every field comes with sacrifices and great things too.
Did you love being a nurse? And if acting hadn't panned out, do you think you would have been happy years later being a nurse?
Let me tell you, this past year I was thinking of going back to just, you know, have my RN license.
Are you serious?
Yeah, I was thinking of that. I was like, damn, I should just finish and have it just in case, because you never know.
And also because that's kind of cool.
It is. I love to help people. I have a lot of plates, remember? A lot of plates. I just carry a lot of plates.
You're a busybody, aren't you?
Yeah.
You can't really stop.
Yeah, I love to help people. Like, if I see someone out, and I just love helping. It makes me feel good, and that's self-centered. Makes me, that's why I help. No, it's great. I would do nursing. I love it. I don't know if I would go back. Mm-hmm. I don't know. Time could only tell. You know.
But do you think you would be happy years later just doing that?
I wouldn't.
If you had never gotten Orange is the New Black?
I probably would, because I would have done, like, traveling nurse and traveled the world, and I would be happy in a position of power as a nurse. I love power. You know, I love being like nurse manager, right. You know, and direct people on where to do.
I would be happy if I was lording over others. You sure, know? Yeah.
I am regal. I was regal in my past life. But yeah.
Two more questions. Next one, right here.
Hi, Ms. Dascha Polanco. I just wanted to say you are spectacular, and you've been speaking facts all afternoon.
Thank you.
I wonder, when you're on set but you're not filming, where do you go to prep yourself?
To prep. I kind of do that in my dressing room. And prep for me happens from the moment that you get the material. I think that's my process. I start like adding the experiences to what's currently written about. And then once I get there, you know, I take my moment. You know, although, you know what I was doing? I listened to music a lot to prep me. Like, if I have a sad, like, scene, and I know it's about something, I tend to go back and reflect on music that makes me really sad so I could go into that place. Because if everybody's having a good time and, like, laughing, oh, my God, we're shopping at, I don't know, online, you know, you have to like take a moment. So I usually use music. Like if I have a bad scene that I'm like listening to Biggie and like, here we go. You know, if I'm, you know, romance, I listen to some Julio Iglesias and Bolero, do all that kind of stuff. Music, I think, is so great. Just, I don't know, it's connecting. It's a lot of energy in music.
It can very quickly connect you to an emotion.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah. Is Orange, is the prison essentially built on a stage?
Half.
And
then there's some now that we film in Queens.
In an actual...
Yeah, in the Queens
prison
jail.
Facility, yeah, the Queens jail.
Am I allowed to say that? I don't know, but I've said it a couple of times in my interview, so yeah.
Wow, okay.
Yeah.
I think we have time for a couple more questions right
here. Yes.
Hi. Hi. Who's your favorite person to act with?
Robert De Niro.
My favorite person to act with. You know, I don't have a favorite person to act with. I think that it's great to be able to, like... My favorite actor to work with is one that's generous and that allows to plays with you, that it's as free as you are. Because when you work with an actor that restricts himself, it makes it hard for the dynamic to work. So I always look onto that. See, I'm not gonna give you names. Next question.
One more, right here.
Hi.
Hi.
Basically, I know that every single character has its own personality and just its own story. And if you could play a different character in the show, who would it be?
A different character. I think I would want to play like one of the guards. Like maybe like a male figure. Or maybe the prison ward in power. Prison ward. I'll play a prison ward.
That sounds like a great fantasy sequence in Orange is the New Black, where all of the women become the guards and all of the
Bennett
male guards.
And then
falls
in love with me then, and I'm in power then.
There
and
it
I'm
is,
like,
yeah.
I'm walking out of your life. You're fired. power.
Oh. Dascha, I love Orange is the New Black so much. Thank you so much
Thank
for coming
you.
In. Congratulations on all your success.
Thank you.
I loved hearing your story of how you got there. The sixth season of the show is on Netflix now. And I think The Irishman is coming out like next year at some point, whenever they finish it. Everybody, big round of applause for the great Dascha Polanco. Let's hear it.